Good morning, students. Today we'll be doing the poem The Darkling Thrush by Thomas Hardy. Hardy wrote this poem to lament the end of the 19th century, which he feels was far way better than what is about to come. The modern age was characterized by the lack of respect for human life, storms of war in Europe, countries fighting among themselves to acquire wealth and resources. There was greed for money, decline in social and moral values. So all these things were happening at that time, which greatly depressed Hardy. And so he wrote this poem at the end of the 19th century, and he laments the death of the 19th century. Before we start with the poem, let me give you a brief introduction of Thomas Hardy. Thomas Hardy was born on 2nd June 1840 in Dorset, England. Although he started his career as an architect, but he had a flair for writing poetry. However, the publishers never published his poems. So he tried his hand at writing novels. Some of his famous novels are Under the Greenwood Tree, A Pair of Blue Eyes, Far from the Madding Crowd, The Return of the Native, and The Mayor of Casterbridge. Though he is often called a pessimist, as his novels send him end on a happy note, yet he never considered himself to be a pessimist. He called himself a meliorist. Who is a meliorist? A meliorist is one who believes that man can live with happiness if he understands his place in the universe and accepts it. Thomas Hardy also seems to be deeply affected by Charles Darwin's theory of evolution. Man, who believed that he was an image of God, had been subjected to the fact that he was nothing but an after effect of evolution. So this is what the Darwin's theory of evolution talks about. And this poem is also a result of the impact of Darwin's theory of evolution on Hardy, right? Hardy was deeply affected, and it had the Darwin's theory of evolution had a very deep impact on this Thomas Hardy. So in this poem, what happens? You will, once we'll read the poem, you will find that the narrator is in a very sad and a depressed mood. As I told you earlier, that the century is about to end, the century is coming to an end, and the poet is mourning, or the narrator is mourning the death of the century. But in the last stanza, what happens? In this last two stanzas, you will find that there is a tiny thrush which emerges as a star to tell the world that there is hope for a better thing. So that thrush, you'll find that a thrush emerges out of nowhere, and that's the song which is being sung by the thrush creates hope in the poet or the narrator, and the thrush's song echoes with the message, if winter comes, can spring be far behind. This I leant upon a coppice gate when frost was spectred grey, and winter's dregs made desolate the weakening eye of day. The tangled pine stems caught the sky like strings of broken lyre, and all mankind that haunted nigh had sought their household fire. In the first stanza, which the poet has talked about the dreary and the bleak winter landscape. It is the end of day. In fact, it is the end of the 19th century. And the poet is leaning against a wooden gate, which opens into the woods. That gate, coppice gate means wooden gate. The poet is leaning against a wooden gate, and that wooden gate opens up into the woods. And the last remains, that is the dregs. What is the meaning of dregs? Dregs means the last remains or the sediments. So the last sediments of winter, that is the last remains of winter has left everyone cheerless, deserted and sore and bitter. So nobody is happy in such an environment, right? Everyone is sad. There is gloom everywhere. There is sadness everywhere. And the presence of frost has made this landscape as gray as a ghost. Spectre-gray means as gray as a ghost, right? So, and then what the poet says, the poet says that the weakening eye of day. So, the weakening eye of day means that the eye of sun, that is the sun is becoming weaker. It means that it is the time of evening, right? It's only in evening that the day's eye becomes weak when there is no light, right? So the day's eye, that is the sun, which is the source of light and life, is also setting. And a gradual blindness is presiding over all the forces of nature. And the speaker also looks towards the sky. The speaker is standing there all by himself and he tries to look out into the sky. But what happens? But his vision, his sight is restricted by the tangled vines. What he could see, he's not able to look at the sky. Why? Because of those tangled vines. Tangled vines means those interwoven vines. You know, this is the time of winter, and in winter what happens? The trees, they shed off their leaves, and the poet can only see the stems and the branches, which are devoid of all greenery. There is no greenery to be found. And the vines look like the broken bits of lyre. What is a lyre? Lyre is a musical instrument, right? So these tangled vines of trees, that is the tangled branches of the interwoven branches of the trees, they have been compared to the strings of lyre. Now, hence the poet knows that he cannot expect music in such a bleak surrounding. What will happen? This environment will only augment, and this environment will only increase his pain and suffering. All the mankind that depended upon the sun to provide them with positive light and strength during the day. See, what happens in winter? In winter, people, they like to be in the sun during the day, and in the evening, they go back to their houses, right? And burn fire to keep themselves warm. So now they all have curled up by the fires in their home, and there is no one to be seen, right? So all the people who were out during the day to acquire the positive light, to absorb the positive light and strength from the sun, they have all gone back to their home, and they are sitting by the fire in their houses. This suggests that modern man is seeking isolation, and modern man is distancing himself from modern human beings. They are distancing themselves from each other. Now let's look at the poetic devices used here. In this stanza, you can see that frost has been personified in the second line. Personification has been used. Frost is personified, and then winter's dregs. So winter has also been personified here. And then another figure of speech which you can find is the tangled vine stems scorch the sky. So it is an alliteration. And then there is a simile in the next line, that is like the strings of broken lyre. So the three figures of speech have been used here. That is, frost and winters have been personified, and there is an alliteration in this line, the tangled vine stems, and there is a simile also. Now let's move on to the next stanza. The land's sharp features seem to be the century's corpse outlined. His crypt, the cloudy canopy, the wind, its death lament. The ancient pulse of German birth was shrunken hard and dry, and every spirit upon earth seemed powerless as I. So we can see that in this stanza, the things, they go from dull and depressing to outright dismal. There is no life, right, anywhere. No life seems to stir anywhere. And the speaker uses a metaphor to describe the barren landscape as a corpse of the 19th century. You can see the century's corpse. So century has been personified here, right? Why? Because only like living beings can have dead bodies, right? So the century's corpse is lying there. It has been stretched out there. And the landshaft features seem to be, that means the outline of the winter landscape. It appeared to be like a corpse of the century, that the dead body of the century. The landscape becomes a map of everything that has happened over the course of the century. So this entire winter landscape, it seems like a map of whatever happened during the century, and now it is lying there dead, lifeless, and all the forces of nature, they seem to have conspired to mourn the passing of the century. So you can see in this line, the fourth line, the poet says, sorry, in the third line, you can see the script, the cloudy canopy means the clouds. The clouds, they act as a tomb for the century. Canopy means cover, and crypt means tomb. So these clouds, what are they doing? They are providing a tomb to cover the dead body of the century. The wind, it's death lament. And what is the wind doing? The wind is singing the death song. That is the death lament. That is the lament song is being sung by the wind. The ancient pulse of German birth. What is the ancient pulse of German birth? Means the life form elements, all the elements of which lead to life, right? The life forming elements, they have all shrunken and they have all lost. So shrunken, hard and dry means again they are all dead. There is no life, right? As we know that there is no life during the winter season, right? No germination takes place. There is no new beginning of life during this time of the year, right? So that is why the poet has said this, that the ancient pulse of German birth was shrunken, hard and dry. So everything is lying there, which is dead, hard and dry. And every spirit upon earth seemed powerless as I. Powerless means without energy, lifeless, so without any vigor. So everything seemed to be dispirited and lifeless, like the speaker. So speaker is also in a very depressed mood, and the environment means everything which is in the environment seems to be as sad as the speaker, as gloomy as the speaker. So there is no enthusiasm, there is no energy. At once a voice arose among the bleak twigs overhead in a full-hearted even song of joy illimited. An aged thrush, frail, gaunt and small, in last bereft noon, had chosen thus to fling his soul upon the growing gloom. So what happens when the poet was in such a depressed and sad and gloomy mood? What happened out of, and the whole environment was in a powerless, lifeless. The whole environment was lifeless and powerless. What happened all of a sudden? All of a sudden, out of that gloom and silence which was pervading everywhere, what happened? The speaker heard something. Like, what did the speaker hear? The speaker heard a happy song. At once a voice arose, the bleak twigs overhead. Bleak twigs means all those dark and dull twigs which were overhead. See, the twigs without leaves will appear to be dull. So from those dark twigs, from those dull twigs, what happened? What did the poet hear? It heard a full-hearted even song. Even song means evening song. Full-hearted means full of energy. Means it was a very happy song which the bird was singing. It was a song of, you can say, resurrection, sound of rebirth. The bird was singing such a happy song of joy unlimited. Illimited means unlimited joy, right? Infinite joy. So the song was full of happiness. The bird was trying, that bird, that small bird, which is a thrush, it was trying to spread happiness to that dull, depressed surroundings, to that sad environment, right? An aged thrush, frail, gaunt and small. Aged thrush means the thrush was, that small bird which was singing the song was very weak. It was aged, it was an old bird, and frail. Frail means weak, gaunt means thin, and the bird was a very small one. So in spite of being very old, in spite of being very weak, in spite of being thin and small, the bird was singing with a lot of energy. The bird was using its entire strength to sing that happy song, to spread happiness in that dull environment. So in blast beruffled plumes, and blast beruffled plumes means the feathers, that is the plume means the feathers of the bird, that is the feathers of the bird, were disordered and they were battered because of the cold wind which was blowing. So in with those battered feathers, the bird was still singing. What does this show? That the bird was on the verge of its death. The bird was about to die, but still it was full of so much energy, had chosen thus to fling its soul. Fling his soul means had the bird has chosen to sing ecstatically, means the bird has chosen to spread happiness, right, to this desolate land. Wanted to fill that desolate land with its song of joy. So that is why the bird was singing with its entire strength, with its entire energy. It was simply flinging its soul out upon the growing gloom. So upon the growing evening, the evening which was increasing the gloom, which was increasing the sadness. So the bird was trying to remove it with the help of its song. So little cause for caroling of such ecstatic sound was written on terrestrial things afar and nigh around, that I could think they trembled through his happy good night air, some blessed hope whereof he knew, and I was unaware. So in this last stanza, what is the speaker saying? He says that there is so little cause for caroling. Caroling means singing. There is no reason for the bird, no good reason for the bird to be singing at this hour, when everything is so sad, everything is so gloomy. There is no life, there is no hope. Why is this bird singing? So the speaker feels that the world is dead. So, and the corpse of the century is lying in front of the poet. So everything is dead, everything is lifeless. So what is the reason? Why, what is the reason for this bird to sing such a merry song? Ecstatic sound means joyful sound. So why is the bird singing in such a joyful sound, singing such a happy sound? So the poet is unable to comprehend, unable to understand this fact. So terrestrial things. What is the meaning of terrestrial? Terrestrial means earthly things. When was written on terrestrial things? So the poet says, when all the objects of the earth, when all the worldly objects, they don't have any promising sign. Right? So everything is dead, everything is shattered, everything is so desolate. Then why is the bird, why is this thrush singing a happy song. This is something which the poet is unable to understand. So afar and nigh around. Afar and nigh around means, nigh means near. Afar means at a distance. So as far as the poet could see, whether it is at a distance or whether it is near the poet. So nowhere he could see any sign of happiness, any sign to be jubilant, any sign to be in a joyful mood. So then what happened? The song of the thrush was like a jubilant outpouring against the gloom of the evening, against that gloomy evening. So this is what the bird is doing. The bird is singing a happy song and poet is confused. He's trying his level best to understand the reason. So in the end, what does the poet conclude? He says that though the dreary landscape gave the thrush no reason to sing with such overflowing happiness, and this is what the speaker is wondering. Whether now the speaker concludes the poem by saying that maybe the bird is a harbinger of some hope. Maybe the song of bird carries, the poet is not able to understand the song of the bird. And so that is why he concludes the poem by saying that maybe the song of the bird carries some hope, some spirit of renewal, right? Which the poet fails to understand. Some blessed hope is there in the song of the bird, which I fail to understand, which I am unaware of, but this bird seems to be acquainted with it. So the speaker sees a ray of hope for a better century in the last stanza. He is hopeful that the upcoming century, that is the 20th century, will be a better one. Song of the thrush embodies some newness, some positive things coming up to heal the wounds of mankind. The wounds of mankind which have been inflicted during the end of this century. That may be healed. That is the hope with which the poet ends his poem. Here, hope has also been personified. So with this, we come to